Today's topic is nested classes or inner classes. So these are the set of topics that we are going to cover. So let's learn what a nested class is. A nested class is a class defined in another class. Pretty simple. There are two different kinds of nested classes: static nested class and non-static nested classes. Static nested classes are nested classes with a static modifier, and non-static nested classes are nested classes that do not have static modifier. And non-static nested classes are called inner classes as well, and these inner classes are the ones that typically we deal with for most of our application. So this is an example of outer class, and inside the outer class we have defined two nested classes. The first one is static nested class, and the next one is inner class or non-static nested class. So why use nested classes? It simplifies coding by logically grouping classes that are only used in one place. So if you have class A and class B is used only in class A, then you can include class A as a nested class inside class A. It increases encapsulation. Example scenario is like this. Suppose you have two top-level classes A and B, and B needs to access to members of A, even private members of A. Now, if they are not nested, then class B cannot access private members of A. However, if B is a nested class inside class A, non-nested by the way, the non-static nested class, and then class B can access private members of A. So it provides higher level of encapsulation. And it increases readability and maintainability as well, mainly because they are grouped together. Okay, so static nested class. So static nested class is like a top-level class that happened to be nested in another top-level class, and they are mostly used for packaging convenience. Let's go to the topic of accessibility scope. Inner classes, which are non-static nested classes, have access to members of enclosing class or outer class even if the members are declared as private. As we talked about in the previous slide, it enhances the encapsulation. However, static nested classes do not have access to other members of the enclosing class, as we talked about. Okay, so let's move on to inner class. So, as I said before, inner class is the one that you are going to deal with most of the time. So, let's talk about object instance of an inner class, meaning how you can create object instance of inner class. In other words, how to instantiate the inner class. Just like other instance methods and instance variables of outer class, inner class is considered as the instance object. So inner class is associated with an instance of its enclosing class and has direct access to that object methods and fields. So the inner class is associated with an instance. It cannot define any static member itself because it is associated with an instance. So objects that are instances of inner class exist within an instance of outer class. So this is the picture that describes this concept. So you have instance of outer class, and inside instance of outer class, so inside an object of outer class, instance of inner class exists. So you can think of instance of inner class is almost like instant member of outer class object. So how can you create an instance of inner class? So in order to create an instance of inner class, you must first instantiate outer class, meaning you have to create an outer object, object instance of the outer class first, and then you can create an instance of object instance of inner class within that outer object. So here is an example. So we create object instance of outer class, just like normal programming. And then from the outer object, meaning object instance of outer class, we use new keyword, and then we provide the name of the class. And that's the way you are going to create object instance of inner class. And this type, outer class.inner class, basically describing the type of this inner class object. So this is a use case. We have a few use cases of inner class. So inner classes can be used to implement helper classes that are not used by other classes. So it provides better readability. So let's say we have a data structure class. And this also data structure class is the outer class. It has a private member of this array of ints array, and it has a public method of print even. Now what we can do is that we can create inner class called inner event iterator. So this is functioning as helper class. And inside this helper class, it has a getNext method. And inside this method, it can access all the members of outer class. For example, even private member of outer class called array of ints. So we use this inner class as a utility class, and we create object instance of inner class by saying this.new. So this is outer object instance. And then we use the new keyword and name of the inner class, and then we got the type of the inner class, and then we can invoke whatever method we have for that inner class object. Use case number 2. So what if you want to use an adapter class but do not want your public class to inherit the adapter class? So in that case, you do not want to be a subclass of adapter class, yet you want to use the adapter class. So for example, if you write an applet and you want your applet subclasses to contain some code to handle mouse events. Since your class has to implement applet because you're building an applet, yet you want to provide an adapter that handles mouse events, so in the form of mouse adapter class. So you are going to define an inner class inside your applet subclass that extends mouse adapter class. So let's see an example of this. So here, because I have extended applet class, I cannot extend the mouse adapter class here because Java does not allow multi-inheritance. So here we create inner class called myAdapter, which extends mouse adapter, and we are implementing this method, and then we are passing an object instance of myAdapter for adding it to the sum object as a mouse listener object. Use case number 3 is if you find you're passing a lot of stuff in the constructor to a class, okay, and then you might want to make this class to be, and also if that class is only used by another class, meaning outer class, then inner classes, usage of inner class, meaning make this class, the target class as inner class, could be a good option. Similarly, if you find you are doing a lot of referencing about the class's fields, think of inner class. So instead of actually two separate class, if you make it as inner class, or assuming inner class is used only within that outer class, then making it as inner class could be a good option. Okay, now important concept. For inner class, there are special inner classes called local class or anonymous class. Sometimes they are called local inner class and anonymous inner class. So local inner class is an inner class defined within a body of a method. Anonymous inner class or anonymous class is inner class within the body of a method without having a name. Okay, so you probably have seen lots of examples of anonymous inner class, and we'll see example of that in a few minutes. Okay, first, local inner class. A local class is declared locally within a block of Java code, meaning within a method. So rather than as a member of a class, it is defined inside a block of Java code. Now, defining characteristic of local class is that it is local to a block of code. So it's like a local variable. So local class is valid only when within the scope defined by the enclosing block. So you want to use local class when a class is used only within a method. It might improve code readability. So let's see example of local inner class. So here we have a method called init. So inside the init, we define our inner class here. And because it's defined inside a method, this is a local inner class. Okay, so inside this method, we are going to define this class, and then we create an object instance of that inner class, and then we can actually use it for another method, in this case, as an action listener object. Anonymous inner class is pretty much the same thing, but it doesn't have a name. So because they don't have a name, there is no way to refer to them. For this reason, their declaration must be given at creation time as part of the new statement. So this is the syntax. So you have a new, and then you specify either class or interface, typically the interface, and then you have parentheses, and then you have body of code. So this form of new statement declares a new anonymous class, so there is no name for this particular class. It's just, you know, the a type of this class on interface. So what it does is that it creates a new instance of that anonymous class or interface, and then returns it as a result of the statement. So object instance will be created that has this body, and then will be returned. So this is an example. So, you know, this is something that you probably have seen a lot in GUI programming, swing programming. So one common usage for anonymous class is to provide a very simple implementation of adapter class. And again, adapter class is the one that defines code that is invoked by other object. So here, suppose if I want to create action listener object, so we want to associate that action listener object to a button, what we can do is we can say new and action listener, this is an interface, right? And then parentheses, and then block of code. And this block of code contains a method, in this case, action performed. So an object instance that contains this block of code, and the type of action listener is going to be created and then returned, and that's what gets used here. So this is the code that you are going to see a lot in GUI programming, as I said before. Okay, so this is a primary example of anonymous inner class, usage example. Okay, so performance implication, nothing really, deviating from what we expected. When considering whether to use inner class or not, keep in mind that application startup time and memory footprints are typically directly proportional to the number of classes you load. So the more classes you create, the longer your program takes to start up and more memory it will take. But, unless you're actually creating lots of actually inner classes, it's probably not usually a problem. Okay, so that's the end of the presentation. Okay, so let's take a look at the hands-on lab of Java inner class. So exercise one is for object creation and scoping. So let's take a look at that. So inner class scoping. So when you run the application, basically this exercise shows that from the inner class method can access private and just members of the outer class object, even though those members are private methods or private variables. Okay, so access from inner class, access data from the outer class, access data to, yeah, so let's take a look at the code. I'm going to use documentation. So here, this is the outer class, and outer class have private variable, protected, and default, and public scope. And then we define inner class called inner class, and inner class has a method called my inner class method, and here we are accessing variables of outer class, as well as we are invoking a method of outer class, and here we are creating object of outer class, and then as we talked about in the presentation, from the outer object instance, we are going to create inner class object. So outer object dot new, and then inner class, and then you get inner class object instance whose type is outer class dot inner class. And we display data from both outer class and inner class, and then we are calling inner class object and my inner class method. Basically, we are calling this guy, this method, and again in this method, we are accessing instance variables and methods of outer class object. Okay, so exercise two is a static nested class. So here we are basically showing that you can't access. You can't access the members of outer class. So here we have outer class, and we have the same set of variables, and then we define static nested class with a static modifier. Now, if you try to access the outer class members, and then you got the compile errors. Okay, so let's just take a look at that. Here, so these are the two methods. So here, if you are trying to access the members of outer class, default data, and the method, and that's a compiler. So non-static variable default data cannot be referenced from static context. Okay. And here we create static nested class, the object, from outer class. So instead of object instance, as we have seen for non-static nested class, we are using outer class and then static nested class, inner class. Okay, so exercise 3 is inner class use case. So this is where inner class is used as a utility class. Okay, so here, this is the same code that we have seen in the presentation. So this is outer class called the data structure and has a private variables called size and array of ints. And then we defined inner class, so private class inner event iterator. And here the methods of inner class can access instance variables of outer class. And then we create an object instance of inner class, and then we can call that object method. So this is an example where inner class is used as utility class. Okay, now exercise 4 is we are looking at examples of local class and anonymous class. So here we let's take a look at the local class first, and then we'll take a look at the anonymous class. This is the local class example here, and then this is an example of anonymous class. So this is a local class. As you can see, class is defined inside a method. So this is the outer class, and inside, well, this class has a method called the getCounter, and it actually returns counter object. And so inside the getCounter method, we define a local class called localCounter, and localCounter implements counter, and basically it returns a local counter object. We create the local counter object and return that as an object instance. Okay, so same code is same factory method for getting a counter object can be done using anonymous inner class. So anonymous inner class doesn't have the name. So here, basically, we are creating counter object. So counter is interface, and it has a method called the next, right? So it's an interface and parentheses, and then it will create an object instance that has this body, okay, as a class, then it will return it, and that's a counter type. Now, this is an example where local class has the constructor method. And this is the anonymous class, because it doesn't have a name, it has just instance initiator. Okay. All right. And here, basically, we are calling the class, local inner class, and then call the get counter method of this guy, and to get the counter object. And then we are using the method of the counter object. And here is this example is the same, except here it's using anonymous inner class. It's using getCounter2 method in which anonymous inner class is defined. Exercise 5 is anonymous inner class, the same example of this one. Okay, but this is more pervasively used in UI example, as I said before. So when you run this application, so let's run this application, anonymous, when you run this application, and you have this GUI, and press the button to close the application, just like this, okay, it's a relatively simple application. Okay, so here we have button, and we want to associate action list and object. So the way that we can create action list and object, in this case we are using anonymous inner class. So new, and this is an interface. Action listener is an interface that has action performed method. So basically object instance of action listener that contains this one as logic will be created and then returned, and that's what we are going to use to associate the action listener with the button. Okay. All right, so that's the end of the hands-on lab.